might have heard about SDLC, which is Software Development Lifecycle. In this video, we are going to discuss MDLC, which is a Model Development Lifecycle. We will also compare SDLC with MDLC. SDLC is a process that is used to build software. So just to give you an example, let's say there is a grocery store chain called Kmart, and they want to build their e-commerce website. They will go to any IT company, let's say IT company's name is Infosys, and they will give the requirements of how they want to build their e-commerce website, what kind of features they want to have, and the business manager on the Infosys side will collect the requirements. So the first stage in SDLC is requirement gathering. After that, the business manager will go to engineering team at Infosys, and he will discuss the requirements, and the engineering team will work on a design, and they will also write code to implement the actual website. So after requirement analysis comes the implementation phase, and then they give a software to a testing team or a QA team for doing testing. So then comes the testing phase, and then the software gets deployed. Kmart users will start using it. They will have a feedback, obviously. Then in the next phase, let's say they will say, okay, we have built this basic e-commerce website. I want to have a product recommendation feature on this website. So in that second phase, you'll have product recommendation feature, couple of other feature bug fixes, and the whole cycle then repeats. That is why it is called cycle, software development life cycle, because it's a cycle. It's not like software you once build, it's done. It's a continuous process. Similarly, there is a term emerging in the field of AI, which is called MDLC, or a model development lifecycle. In here also, you have to follow certain steps. Let's say you're trying to build a product using AI, or you're trying to build a model for doing data science. That project consists of similar steps that we just saw for SDLC. And let's go over those steps really quickly. Any machine learning project starts with problem statement, where you try to figure out what problem you want to solve using machine learning. So there comes requirement gathering, goals and milestone, and ROI analysis. The business manager will meet with the stakeholders to figure out, okay, if you are building a recommendation engine for e-commerce website, how exactly that engine is going to work and how it can help company bring more customers or bring more revenues. In general, how you can solve a specific problem using machine learning. Once the problem statement is clearly defined with goal, milestone, and ROI, ROI means a return on investment, then comes design phase, where business manager will go to data scientists or machine learning engineers and talk about the problem that they want to solve. Now, as a data scientist and machine learning engineer, it is your responsibility to figure out first, is ML necessary for my project? Many times a problem can be solved using a rule-based system or a simple software or a regular expression. In that case, you should not use machine learning. Let's say you ruled out that possibility and you think using machine learning makes sense. Then comes what type of problem you're solving, whether it's a classification or regression problem or a reinforcement learning. Then can you use a ready-made solution? For example, you're trying to build a chatbot. Can you use Google's dialogue flow? Or you're trying to work on image classification problem. Can you use Google Vision API? If you can use ready-made solution, then you should definitely go for it if it fits your budget, because it will save you a lot of time. Then comes data collection phase. Let's say I figure out, okay, I don't want to use any ready-made solution. I want to train my own model. Then for building any model, a lot of training data is required. Now, does that training data comes from in-house or from outside? Many times companies have in-house databases, you know, MySQL, or there could be document store or MongoDB. Can we scrap all those databases and prepare a data set that is necessary to train my model? If not, can we use external data? Can we buy data from somewhere? Or can we use web scraping to collect data from the internet? Then comes data annotation phase. Let's say you are trying to do name entity recognition. In that, you have a lot of text. You want to tag specific entities and you need annotation tool. Now, do you want to build that tool in-house or just use ready-made tools such as Prodigy and Super Annotate? There are many data annotation tools available in the market right now. So a business manager needs to carefully evaluate all these tools and figure out if using these tools makes sense in terms of budget and timeliness. Then comes data privacy concern, because we live in a world where if you get into privacy issues, you will have a lot of legal trouble. For example, Google, I think when they trained BERT model on various websites article, they got into lawsuit because those websites publishing news did not want their articles to be used to train the BERT model. So you have to be very, very careful about data privacy if you want to get any legal things clear around that. Then that's the first step you need to take. After data collection comes model training part. So here now, data scientists and machine learning engineers have all of their data ready to train the model. They will take that data set and they will first think whether they want to use statistical machine learning or deep learning. If you have a structured data, many times using statistical learning makes sense. If you have unstructured data such as audio, video, images, then deep learning makes more sense. And deep learning makes even more sense when the volume of data is very, very high. Even in deep learning, if you are working on NLP type of problem, you will use RNN or transformer based models. If you are trying to solve image classification problem, then you will use convolutional neural network. So data scientists and machine learning engineers, they know which model to use in what circumstances. Even for statistical machine learning, let's say you are trying to do classification, you can use random forest, decision tree, logistic regression. There are many methods. So data scientists will use all these methods and they will do hyperparameter tuning. So they will have couple of models that they will try. They will use grid search CV and they will use cross validation to figure out the model with the best score, model that performs the best. And then that model will be evaluated on a test data set. Test data set is the data set that is not used in the training phase. And once it is confirmed that this model with this XYZ hyperparameters needs to be used, they will export that model into pickle file or whatever the file format is, and they will start deploying it. So then comes the deployment phase. In the deployment phase, you need to figure out whether you want to use a simple Flask server to serve the HTTP request, or you want to use something sophisticated such as TF serving. TF serving allows you to tag your models, you know, dynamically load specific version of your model. It has a lot of benefits. There are other serving frameworks as well. You're obviously deploying this to a cloud. So when you deploy it, you need to think about containerization. Docker is a popular tool. So can we have a Docker container with our model and with all the libraries installed? And once you have a container, you can deploy it in Google Cloud, Amazon, Azure, whatever your cloud provider is. And you need to obviously do artifact management, which means I have this model version 1.1, then I retrain now version 1.2. So 1.1, 1.2 behaves in a different way. You need to have a catalog that 1.2 was trained on this particular data set. 1.1 was trained on that particular data set. And what was the model? What was the hyperparameter? You need to have all that metadata associated with an artifact. So you need to certainly do that artifact management. And once the model is up and running, let's say it's serving the needs of customer. Let's say you build recommendation engine for an e-commerce website. Now for e-commerce website, people are going on the website, they are being shown the recommendation. Now you need to evaluate the performance of that model in a production environment. So you need to do live monitoring. And for that, you need to have a lot of logs. Splunk is a standard software that people use for logging. Then you need to have alarms set up, you know, if there is an error that occurred or if the model is not behaving in the right way, we can have proper alarms installed. And you need to measure the accuracy of inference. And by doing that, you will get a good understanding of how the model is performing in the wild. All of these steps can be automated if you use the right set of frameworks. So nowadays there are ML ops frameworks available, such as MLflow, Amazon SageMaker, Kubeflow, which is for Kubernetes. And these platforms allow you to automate a lot of these processes that we talked about. For example, if you go to Amazon SageMakers, you will get a lot of containers, pre-trained models. You will have tools for data annotation. It will automate a lot of the processes that we already discussed in your MDLC process. After monitoring comes retraining. Because once you monitor, let's say, and then you found some issues, now you want to retrain the model. Also, the data is ever evolving. So now after 1 year, you collected more data. Let's say for product recommendation engine, you got few new products. So now you need to retrain that model, you know? So it's like continuous training. You might have heard about CI/CD, continuous integration, continuous development. Similarly, there is continuous training, CT, you know, you can call like CT. And based on production monitoring and changing business needs, you need to retrain that model, collect new data, again retrain. And then you need to really look at your problem statement, like what new features I want in my model product, basically. And based on that, you retrain, then again it goes to design phase, because now let's say my requirements are changed, my data is changed. Previously I used decision tree, now maybe using random forest makes more sense. So in that case, data scientists are continuously engaged and you are kind of in a cycle, you know, you are kind of in a circle. That's why it's called model development life cycle. You know, the term cycle means it's a cycle, it's a continuous process. It's not like once you build an AI product and you are done. You have to continuously do the iteration, monitor it, and continuously evolve the product. And that's what MDLC is all about. I hope you like this video. If you learn something new, please share it with your friends who can also learn what is MDLC. And thank you for watching. If you have any question, please post in a comment below.